Hey, what's up, Revolution? How are you? Doing good? Doing good. It's good to see everybody. I've been excited to get here all week, and I'm sure that the Lord won't let me down. He's been pumping me up all week to get here and hang out with you guys, and so I got some warriors here, right? Right, Mike? Yeah, got some warriors. It's not for everybody, is it? It's not for everybody. I think they did an article in the paper today. Some of you may have seen it in the Daily Commercial, and in it, it says that we're going to preach God's word unapologetically. where is everybody? And I don't think they like to hear that, you know, so, oh well. But we're going to do it because I believe that God is going to build his church on his word, and so that's what we're going to continue to do. We're kind of shaking it up a little bit here. We're going to talk about the obvious elephant in the room, which is that there was no music. But we're shaking it up a little bit here tonight just to do things a little bit different. And I'll tell you a little bit about why we're doing that here in just a few minutes. But we've been going through the Gospel of Luke, and we want to study who Jesus is and what he actually did and what he actually taught. Because there's a lot of rumor and there's a lot of hearsay and mama said this and Google said that and everybody's got their difference of opinion about who Jesus is and we don't want to base our faith and our eternity on hearsay. That would be stupid, right? So we really want to find out what the Bible says about who Jesus is and what he taught and what he said about you and me and our future and all that, right? So we've been studying through the Gospel of Luke so that we could worship him in spirit and in truth. We're working on the truth part so that we could amp up this whole spirit thing, right? Just get fired up about Jesus, right? I'm fired up about Jesus. I've been fired up about Jesus for a long time. He's amazing. And I was talking to my Jewish sister over here a little bit ago. Jesus was kept from me for like 30 plus years. When the veil finally opened up and I could see the truth, that fired me up. And I started eating cheeseburgers. It was awesome. God is good. Yeah, I didn't even prep you guys. That was a good one, man. Well, you ready, Ray? And all the time? You guys are so Baptist. I love you all. Listen, so we took a detour from the Gospel of Luke last week, but it was a good detour. It was a natural progression of things. We needed to take this detour because what was happening is we're stockpiling all this knowledge about who Jesus is so that we could worship him correctly, right? So because we want to be a church that is the real deal. We don't want to be some phony church. We don't want to be some church that's making up something on our own or recreating the wheel, right? So we wanted to find out what's all this stuff that we're gathering here? What's that all look like as a church, as a corporate gathering of people? And so we took a detour from Luke, and this is kind of weird. Like, there's more people over here than there's over here. So, like, I'm not going to diss you. I'm going to acknowledge you on occasion, but it's kind of tough. Okay? So give me some grace. When anyone else walks in, you tell them to go over there. Kick them out of your seat. Just send them that way, okay? Show them the real love. Don't sit next to me. Now, where is everybody tonight? Say, they're missing out. That's right, right? They're missing out. It's a cute little dude right there. It's that cute little dude right there. I know that guy. Oh, yeah. The singer's in the house. Yeah, buddy. Our worship leader right there, that little dude. So I don't even know where I was. He is a cute little dude. He's distracting. So, wow. You make your plans, right? Yeah, so we wanted to find out what was going on. Like, we want to know what the real church is supposed to look like. So we studied a little bit in that fertile ground known as Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4, and when the church first started, and this is what they did, and in this fertile ground, God did the miraculous. Like, thousands of people were coming to the Lord. Like, daily, the people were getting saved, and it was an amazing, amazing launch of the church. And I'm like, man, that's the same Jesus yesterday, today, and forever. He did it back then. Why isn't he doing it now? And I think that he wants to. Like, I don't think that he changes.
And so I think that he wants to do that now, but we saw what it's going to take to get there. God is poised and ready to bless his church, but we have to do some things, right? There's things that we could do to provoke his motion. There's things that we could do to induce new life in our church. And we went over it last week, and we saw that the thing that God blesses is the devotion of all of his people. They're devoted to some things. They weren't part-time in it, you know what I'm saying? They were all in. They were devoted to God's word. And you know what? It said that they were devoted to the apostles' teaching. So I'm sure that they actually picked up Bibles and read them. But they were, the apostles' teaching that we have now is in a book, right? We read it. Their stuff that the apostles wrote wasn't written yet. So what were these people doing? What you're doing right now. They were devoted to coming to temple every day to hear God's word taught and preached. They were devoted to this thing. Do you know that in the scriptures it said that Jesus went to the temple every day? That's devotion, y'all. That's devotion. He didn't, I don't know about your Jesus, but my Jesus, he doesn't do anything half-hearted. He's completely all in. He gave his life to establish the church. He shed his blood to establish the church. He led a life of example to establish the church so we would know how to live. Christ followers follow Christ. They were devoted to God's word. They were devoted to the local fellowship. Remember, the fellowship was a group of people meeting together to pursue a common thing. They were all together, they met. They were devoted to the group. They were all devoted to meeting together to pursue a shared interest or an aim, and that person was Jesus Christ. And his mission to build the church, they were devoted to that. They were devoted to hospitality. It said that they opened up their homes daily. People met in the temple like this right here every single day for worship, to learn, to pray. And then after they got done, that wasn't enough. I need more Jesus. Can somebody say that? I need more Jesus. And so I need, when we get done here, can we please go do some more? I need some more of that, right? I hate when the service ends. You guys, I hate it when the service ends because I don't want our service to ever end. I want it to be ongoing all the time. I'd love to take the locks out of those doors up front. That would be one of my little dreams. You guys got dreams? I got dreams. One of my dreams is to take the locks out of the front door of this church and never need them because it's open all the time. That would be incredible. I'm just saying. Just throwing it out there. Just giving you a little vision, something maybe to ponder. They were devoted to God's word. They were devoted to the local fellowship. They were devoted to hospitality, and they were devoted to prayer. They were devoted to prayer. They knew that this thing called the church was only going to happen if God stepped in and did something supernatural. It was not something that their devotion could conjure up. They knew that even though they got together, and even though they opened up the homes, and even though they shared meals, and even though they shared everything, and even though that they learned the word of God, it still wasn't going to be enough. They needed to plead with the Lord, do something, Lord, move. And he did. They were devoted to prayer. I just want to throw this out there every Monday night right here, 7-8. That's what we're doing. We're praying. That's what we're doing. Make time in your schedule. So this was the fertile ground where God births new life. It was incredible. And listen, I don't know about you, but like I'm totally devoted to this thing. I'm all in, right? I'm totally in. And I want to see what happened then happen now. So badly. It consumes me all the time. I'm not alone. I know that a lot of you in this room feel that same way. And what God is asking of you is that your life would reflect that desire and that you would step into that type of devotion. He's not looking for emotion. He's looking for devotion. That's what he's looking for. And that's what I'm asking you to do, is to devote yourself to God's kingdom. So those are the things that build the church. And I don't want to paint some ugly picture and go doomsday on you, but I think that there's some things that kill the church too. And I don't know if this message is going to be a little shorter than last week. I really thought it was, but as I'm sitting up here talking to you, I feel stirred up big time, and I don't know if it's going to be shorter. But I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on what kills the church. But I think that we need to see what Scripture says. We're going back into Luke. I want to see what the Scriptures say about killing the church, because we need to make sure we don't do it, right? It's good to know. It's good to know that if you're going down the highway and there's a nasty turn coming, that there's a sign that says, warning, be careful, man, or you could fall. We need to know. And so here's some warning. Here's some things that destroy the growth of the church. And I'm not talking about the grievous, deviant, obvious, awful sins that make the 6 o'clock news. Those will kill a church too. And we need to pray for our church leaders, because when a church leader falls, then he takes the church with him. And we need to pray for these people. I make it a habit of praying for the other pastors in our community on a regular basis, because they have a bullseye on them. I make it a habit of praying for our worship team, because as I shared with my brother Andy this week, the worship team goes out before the rest of the soldiers, and they take the arrows. That's what happens. And you need to understand that he's going to attack you, but you need to stand firm, because you're in a war, and persevere and keep going. Don't take the bait of Satan. It's coming. Don't act as if you're surprised, like something crazy is happening. If you're on the worship team, you're going to get it. Don't take the bait. Keep marching. Okay? So I'm not talking about the big, nasty things that you know, the crime, like on TV crime, that breaks down a church. I'm talking about the things that maybe they're a little bit... they're a little more subtle, but nevertheless, they destroy a church. That's it right there. Why don't people go to church? How many people have been in active ministry at some point in their life? Raise your hand. Okay. And how many of you have asked people, why don't you go to church? And they answered you right there. Same hands, right? Same hands. It's hypocrisy. And that's why people don't go to church. That's a big, huge axe to the base of the tree. It's a huge wrecking ball to the foundation of the church. You know what the people are saying when they say hypocrisy? This is what they're saying. This is their definition. Their definition is this what I see. The thing I hear coming out of your mouth, the reality is, what I'm seeing is not the same as the claim. That's the problem. You're all phony. You're fake. You say one thing, but you do another. You profess to be something, but you're not. You're fake. You're a hypocrite. When the behavior, what is seen, what really is, doesn't conform to the claim, that's hypocrisy. You know, it's a Greek word. It's a theater reference. I'll see if I can pronounce it, but it's hupokrinesthai. It's to play a part, right? It's an actor or an actress, right? It's not who I really am. It's who I'm pretending to be, and that's what people see in the church. And that's why the seats aren't full. And that's why we don't add services to our schedule, because of hypocrisy in the church. Do you know who this guy is up on the screen? The Rock. Who said that? Mike. He's The Rock, right? You guys all know who he is? Listen, don't tell me I'm the only wrestling fan in here. I'll just confess openly right now. Right? I love The Rock. Love him. I guess. He's a good person. I don't know. It's all I know is that the more rude and obnoxious he was, the more I liked him. right? He's awesome. For years and years, he would thrill the audience by the hundreds of thousands, millions worldwide with his antics. And he would beat people up, and then he had a nasty mouth, and he would rip people down, and the more he did it, the more people loved him. For years, when he started doing movies, it said starring The Rock. Did you know that he doesn't live in the SmackDown Hotel at the corner of Jabroni Drive?
Oh, man.
And Know Your Role Boulevard? He don't live there. As a matter of fact, that's not even his name. That's Dwayne Johnson.
Yeah.
But he pretended for years and years to be someone that he wasn't. He's obnoxious and loud, right? But when they interview him in real life, he's not like that. He's a gentle giant. He used to play for the U. You're a U guy, right?
Yeah.
And he was good, just not good enough. And since he couldn't make it in football, he tried this. I think he did all right. He's doing all right for himself, right? Just barely making by Pray For Him. Barely making it, right? Barely making it. That's not really who he is. He's Dwayne Johnson. You know, I could do this. I could put this thing on and I could tell you that I was Thor. Right? I could be Thor. And I could tell you that I could go from one world to another, and I'm a superhero, and I got this amazing hammer that I could swing, and I could bash a bus and bust through walls and all that, right? I could tell you that I had that. Would you believe me? You should. But you know what? I could put a mask on. And I can have that facade all I want, but, you know, Thor's not real. But I will say this, when you look at the movie Thor, and you look at that dude, and then you look at me, you know, real quick, I ain't him. I'm just saying he's eye candy for the ladies, right? Come on now. And I ain't. They don't have too many bald, fat, middle-aged Jewish guys as superheroes. I'm not him. At all. You know, the Word of God speaks a lot about this hypocrisy. Psalm 19:14 says, may the words of my mouth, right, that's the outward, what we see, what we hear, what people see and hear of you, and the meditation of my heart, that's what's going on inside, be pleasing to you, O my Lord. And see, so Jesus is just as much concerned about the inside as the out and the outside as the in. It should match. Let both of them be pleasing to you. The Apostle Paul was speaking to this young guy, Titus. There's a book named Titus in the Bible. And in chapter 2, verse 1, he says this to Paul. He says, to promote the kind of living. In other words, encourage people to live a certain way. That's the outward. That's what people would see, right? Promote the kind of living that reflects wholesome teaching. So in other words, think of a mirror. What people would see in the mirror should be God's word. When they look at you, you should look like Jesus in a sense. You should act what it's... This is... You're here every single week and you're hearing this stuff poured out to you. And what should happen is when people see you, they should see this book. It should reflect this when they see you. And he's like, listen, I'm encourage the people to do this. Because their natural tendency is to come in and to listen, but not do. Anyone have parents? Right? They told you what to do, and you didn't do it. And that's what we do. We're all human. We don't like to do what we're told. So that's why Paul was encouraging him, don't just preach the word, but encourage them to actually do what it says. Remember, James said that. Don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. Why? Or else you're just fooling yourself. You could call yourself a Christian all day long. You could call yourself Thor all day. But if you don't do as Thor's supposed to do, you ain't Thor. And if you're not doing what the Bible says the Christian should do, you're not a Christian. You're a wannabe, but you're not a Christian. In that same chapter, he says to Titus this, listen, verse 7. Let everything, can you look at somebody and just say everything? Everything. Total. What is it in Spanish?
Total.
Like the dog? Toto?
Yeah.
Did you just call me a dodo? So he says this, listen, let everything, that includes most all that you do. Let everything you do reflect, there it is again, the integrity and seriousness of your teaching. Paul's telling him, man, this means business. I'm not just flapping at the gums telling you what you should and shouldn't do, or who God is and who he isn't. I mean it. Integrity, that means that it's the same in the light as it is in the dark. It's the same what I claim and what I do, right? I'm not the guy in church on his best and then the guy at work at my worst. Integrity means the same in both situations, right? Listen, nothing drives people away from the church more than this. When we say that we're one thing, but we act in a different way. I don't know about you, but I have no room in my life for bull. I need the real deal. I want the real deal in my life or I'm out. I ain't got no time for that. I ain't got no time for it at all. And so our dinner tonight from God's word is going to be in Luke chapter 11. And I'm going to read verse 37 through 54 with you. So please turn there. Don't just assume that what I'm going to tell you is the truth when you got a copy of God's word right there. Put your eyes on it. I see some notebooks are out. Some pens are flowing. I like that. The ink is flowing. That's good. I think that's kind of like what Paul was saying to Titus. I mean business. I hear that. I know they mean business. All right, you ready for Luke 11, starting in verse 37. And what you're going to see here is this harsh rebuke from Jesus Christ right out of the mouth of Jesus in red. And it's this harsh rebuke of the hypocrisy that's going on in the church. Back then, it's to the spiritual leaders of the time. And so he's rebuking their hypocrisy, but still today this is on display. And let's address it. This is the warning sign on the curve of the highway that you're on. Okay, so this, take heed. You ready? Okay, verse 37. As Jesus was speaking, I think that's just kind of thrown in there so that he's just saying, listen up, y'all. Jesus talks, we listen, right? Remember that? Remember the old ads? Smith Barney? When he talks, people listen. When Jesus talks, you need to listen. As Jesus was speaking, one of the Pharisees, the religious leaders at the time, just call them the in today's context, like the bishops, the overseers, the top dogs of the religious world back then, okay? So one of the Pharisees invited him home for a meal. So he went in, Jesus went in, and took his place at the table. His host, that Pharisee, that guy, was amazed to see that he sat down to eat without first performing the hand-washing ceremony required by Jewish custom. Then the Lord said to him, "You Pharisees are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and wickedness. Fools! Didn't God make the inside as well as the outside? So clean the inside by giving gifts to the poor, and you will be cleaned all over. What sorrow awaits you, Pharisees." Now listen, some translations won't say what sorrow awaits. Some will say, woe to you. Like, it's not like a horse when you go, whoa, baby. No, woe as in bad stuff's coming. Heads up. The way you're living is not going to end well for you. That's what woe means. What sorrow awaits you, Pharisees? Woe to you. For you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb garden. You see the little pot outside grandma's kitchen window in like Oklahoma? Little plants in it. Got to have a little oregano. A little thyme. Got to pick off one leaf for you and 9 leaves for me and 1 leaf for you, God. But you ignore justice and the love of God. Come on. You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. What sorrow awaits you, Pharisees? Woe to you! For you love to sit in the seats of honor in the synagogues and receive respectful greetings as you walk in the marketplaces. Yes, what sorrow awaits you? For you are like hidden graves in the field. People walk over them without knowing the corruption they are stepping on. Man, I wish I could be bold like Jesus. Teacher, said an expert in religious law, you have insulted us too in what you have just said. One of the greatest understatements in all of the Bible. Just say duh, right? Come on. You've insulted us. Yes, said Jesus, I did. Yes, I did. You got a problem? I could just see him going like this. Yes, said Jesus. What sorrow also awaits you, experts in religious law? He's an equal opportunity insulter, huh? For you crush people with unbearable religious demands and never lift a finger to ease the burden. What sorrow awaits you? For you build monuments for the prophets your own ancestors killed long ago. But in fact, you stand as witnesses who agree with what your ancestors did. They killed the prophets and you join in their crime by building the monuments. This is what God in his wisdom said about you. I will send prophets and apostles to them, but they will kill some and persecute the others. They don't even understand what he's talking about. They're about to have him killed. So they're just as guilty, if not worse, because who's the greatest prophet of all time? Jesus. And they're about to have him killed. What's up, Andrew? Love my brother, Andrew. It's just better church when Andrew's here. I'm just saying. As a result, this generation will be held responsible for the murder of all God's prophets from the creation of the world. From the murder of Abel to the murder of Zechariah, who was killed between the altar and the sanctuary. Say, what? How did you know that, Jesus? That was a long time ago, man. Wow. I guess he saw something from up high, right? Yes, it will certainly be charged against this generation. What sorrow awaits you, experts in religious law. For you remove the key to knowledge from the people. You don't enter the kingdom yourselves, and you prevent others from entering. As Jesus was leaving, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees became hostile and tried to provoke him with many questions. They wanted to trap him into saying something they could use against him. There's God's word. That's a lot to digest. But I heard a preacher tell me today, and I'd say it to you, if you went to a restaurant and they only brought you biscuits, would you be happy? No. We want the main dish. You just got it. Okay, so before we jump into this open rebuke of the Pharisees, look right at the beginning, verse 37, 38. There's like a summary statement here in God's word that addresses much of the problem in the church and much of the problem back then. Look what it says there in verse 37 and 38. As Jesus was speaking, one of the Pharisees invited him home for a meal. So he went in and took his place at the table. His host was amazed to see that he sat down to eat without first performing the hand-washing ceremony, listen to this, required by Jewish custom. There's the problem right there. These things that have the appearance of true religion, but they fail biblical scrutiny. If you search the scriptures, it's not something that God mandates. You don't have to do that, but they started to do it, and they kept doing it, then it became rule, just like the Ten Commandments. That's what happened. It has the appearance of pure religion, of what God would really want. There's all kinds of stuff in the church that gets done that appears to be religious, but it's not. That's for babies, y'all. That's for babies, Robbie. Thank you. You don't want to ever walk in there when mama's nursing, okay? Doing a little housekeeping, everybody. Bear with me. There's a lot of things in church that we do that we don't have to do, but they become rules. It starts with a good idea, and then all of a sudden it becomes a law, and it's like, what are we doing here? And then we don't do it, we get a little freaked out, right? What's up? Why aren't we doing that? Jesus' brother James talked a little bit about this, about real religion, chapter 1, verse 27 of the book, with his name as the title. It talks about pure, like pure, genuine, real religion in the sight of God the Father. Like, he looks down at something, he sees what's real, what's pure. What's pure mean? That means 100% this, and 0% of stuff that you guys come up with, right? This is what he's looking for. Pure, uncut, wholesome, real, 100% his thing. And it says this, it says that real religion, genuine, pure religion is caring for orphans and widows. Say amen. We should do that, right? Stop asking the government to do something we're supposed to, right? Okay. But here's the best part. This is for us. Care for the widows and orphans, but also refuse to let the world corrupt you. You see, there was the pure religion, 100% this, and 0% what we come up with. But what he's saying is that the world's going to try to give you stuff to come up with, and we need to say that's not for us. Nothing that's outside of what God's word says that we should be doing, we should be doing. That's it. Right? Unless you think it's not sufficient. And I'd say that you're very wrong. And so we have to make sure that we don't let the world corrupt us. There's a way that Christianity, real Christianity, is lived out in the sight of God the Father. That's real religion. But then there's when hypocrisy starts to creep in. Right? And customs creep in. This is what we've always done. This is how we do it. They appear to be the real deal, but they're not the biblical requirement of God. How many people felt the feeling of strange when you realized that after Mike got off the stage, that I got up and started preaching instead of listening to music? Do you think that's weird? Right? It's a little weird. How many people have been going to church for more than a year? All hands? Just about? Okay. So of all of you, how many people in the room that had their hand up would say that in their church experience that it was kind of like this? You got to church on Sunday morning and they got up and they did a couple of announcements and they took an offering and they sang three or four songs and the preacher came out and preached and then they kind of closed with a song and went home. How many people... That's what church has been almost 100% of the time, right? So when we don't do it, it's kind of weird. And I could listen. Do you know that I've wanted to do music last for 7 years, and I never get my way around here, never, never. Because you just give up after a while. You choose your mountaintop. You choose your battles, right? I don't want to die on this hilltop. But so we never do music last, but that we get used to. Can I ask you who's read through the whole Bible in your life, right? Can you please show me in there where it says that order? Can you please? I'm open to it. Can you show me? Why? Because it's not in there, but we do it because that's what we always do. It's a custom. Can I just tell you how I feel about it? Okay. This is how I feel about it. What's the ultimate goal of God for all of mankind? It's one word. Boom. Worship. He wants to be worshiped, right? That's the goal. And it's going to take on a lot of different looks. You're going to worship in your way. You're going to worship in your way. In the same house, you're going to worship a little bit differently, right? Mary, we know how she worships. Feed everybody. That's what she does, right? We all do different things. But the ultimate goal of God is that every single human on earth would worship him. Would you agree? So there's something we can unite on. We can fight about a bunch of other stuff, but on this point, we have unity? Okay. So, the part of the service where we sing songs, what do we call that? Worship. Okay. So let me ask you a question. If the ultimate goal of God in all of human, in the whole human race, is that we would worship him, like that's the main dish, right? So why would we bring out the main dish? So you go to, we're going to Olive Garden tonight. You in Olive Garden right now? Can you smell the breadsticks? Okay. So let me ask you a question. You were just there?
No, I said,
oh, okay. There you go, right there, busted. That should come first, right? Whatever your meal was, what if it came first? It's kind of weird. Why do they do that? They build up to that main course. And you just can't wait. And then they give you a little bit of tease, right? Give you a little bread, a little salad. That's good, but it's not steak gorgonzola. Oh, you guys ever had that? That's off the chain, right? That is so stinking good. Man, it's like all this little steak and little red peppers and pasta and oh, man. So why is it that someone decided a long time ago that the music is somehow the hors d'oeuvre? How's that happen? How does the music become the hors d'oeuvre, that the music ushers in the spirit? Can you please show me that? His ultimate goal is that we would worship him, right? So I'm thinking, and look, it's not even the Bible. This is just me. This is not the Bible either. My opinion is not the Bible. My opinion is, okay, if his ultimate goal is that we would worship him, why don't we bring God's word? And so that God can take you to the mat with who he is and your sin and conviction and maybe saying something that you're doing really good and you're rocking at it, and so he encourages you. And in the presence of God, there's fullness of joy maybe. And in that, you get all that. And then we respond in worship. Why wouldn't we do that? I think we need to change church. I think we've been doing it wrong for a long time. I don't know about you. Seems to make sense to me. But we don't have to do it that way. That would just be a custom. My custom. But I think it'd be good. So we're going to do it tonight. We're going to see if it works. Customs are usually rooted in the authentic. They're usually genuine expressions of worship. But let me just say this. They come from something good. But just because you decide that this is what I'm going to do, that doesn't mean it becomes biblically mandated for everyone else. Okay? And that's what we fall victim to. It's the way we've always done it. Fall in the groove, yo, or get left behind. This church is called Revolution, a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. We need to shake things up a little bit to wake some people up, right? To wake them up. So we're going to just shake it up a little bit. It's not, listen, these things that we do in church, they're not what they seem to be. They seem to be authentic expressions of worship that the Bible would even say we should do. But they're not. You know, there's God stuff that repels people from church. Did you know that? This is a good one. There's a difference between God stuff and God's stuff, right? One letter makes a big difference. See, I've seen in my life, and I haven't been a Christian that long, maybe like 15 years, but I've seen some crazy stuff that people do, and they slap the Holy Spirit on it. I've heard people barking like dogs and howling like wolves, and go, oh, that's the Holy Spirit. Really? Show me where that is. There's a lot of God stuff. You can wrap scripture around it and make it sound like the Bible, but it ain't God's stuff. And that's what we're searching for here. That's what we want. It's all hypocrisy. It's hypocrisy. And Jesus, in this text, he goes for the jugular on this stuff, right? And when I mean the jugular, I'm saying this. Not only is he direct in his teaching, right? But think of the context here. Think of the setting. He's in the guy's dining room. He goes to that guy's house. So you've been invited in. Someone invites you into their house and you just sit down and start throwing out insults at everyone. Man, that meatloaf is terrible. And look at that outfit. Who decorated this place? It looks like crap. Like, who would do that? Jesus might. He comes in and he just goes right after it. Be politically correct. Don't offend anybody. Separation of church and state, man. Don't cram your religion down my throat, man. I don't know about your Jesus, but my Jesus ain't no doormat at all. In verse 40, he calls them fools. Imagine that. You finally get invited over to the house. What do you say? Hey, thanks, the steak was great. No, you call him a fool. And then he looks at these guys, the Pharisees, the religious leaders. So he's talking to like the bishops, the overseers, the apostles, the leaders of the day, right? And he says to them, you're not even in the kingdom of God. You're not saved. You're not getting saved. You're not even in the family of God. Can you imagine? Can you imagine being at that dinner? And not only being one of the Pharisees or the experts in religious law, but just being one of the people that are kind of there. And they're hearing this from this guy, this Jesus. And he's in the dining room just ripping these guys. And everyone knew these people. These were the leaders. These were the admired leaders. If anyone in town had it together, if anyone was getting in, it was them. They wore the fancy robes, and they had the big old hats, and they had the long tassels hanging out of their garb. They had all the religious garb on. Everyone knew these guys had it, man. They had their Sunday best on every day. If anyone was getting in, it was them. And they held the highest positions in the faith. They were like, I said, bishops and apostles and high priests. You know what I'm saying? Like the big shots of the faith, you know? And this is who Jesus is talking to. It says in verse 43 that they enjoyed the seats of honor in the synagogue. Look at me. Who do you think you are? You guys need to call me Bishop Moses from now on. Right? It says that they enjoyed the seat of honor and they enjoyed the respectful greetings as they walked in the marketplace. The Matthew account said that they liked it. Walking through town with their big old chef hat on and their robe and tassels. Hey, Rabbi. How you doing? Hey, Rabbi. Hi, teacher. Hi, sir. Titles. Look at me. And they're walking along and said they enjoyed it. Hey, Rabbi. That's me. I'm the rabbi. I'm your leader. Look at me. I'm up here. You're down there. They loved it. They didn't love bringing people into a relationship with the Lord. They loved having their praise. That's what they loved. Their outer appearance, it had this appearance of high religion, but it lacked authenticity. And people saw the mask on these men that Jesus saw their heart. See, they saw the mask that hid the heart that Jesus could see. You know, twice in the Gospel of Luke, before this text, it says that the people were talking, right? And Jesus is just kind of sitting there, just like you are right now. And it said that Jesus knew their thoughts. Right? That's scary. Jesus knew their thoughts. Bible says that man looks at the outside, but God sees in here, right? So what's that make Jesus? Come on. Someone say the G word. God. And also in our text right here, it doesn't say that Jesus knew their thoughts, but think about what happened here. They invite him into the house, and Jesus is sitting there, and the text gives no indication that this man who was amazed that Jesus didn't wash his hands, it never says he said anything. Now, did he say something? I don't know. But it certainly doesn't say it. So we could pretty safe to assume that he didn't say anything. He may have. But he doesn't say that he said anything. But yet, Jesus, knowing the thoughts of the people, he goes right after this guy and he attacks the real problem. Look in verse 39. Verse 39 says, "Then the Lord said to him, 'You Pharisees are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and wickedness. Fools! Didn't God make the inside as well as the outside? So clean the inside by giving gifts to the poor, and you will be clean all over.'" He goes after the heart, the heart, the heart. That's what Jesus is after all the time. And by the way, just for the record, you need to know that giving gifts to the poor is not everyone's medicine for holiness. He was speaking specifically to these people who would the text say are filled with greed. That was a problem. They were all about themselves. And what's the anecdote? What's the medicine for self? Give it away to someone else. So that was the medicine that they needed. I don't know what your medicine is right now. But if you'll pay attention, God will tell you. He will tell you. That's the medicine that these dudes needed. As Pharisees, they knew the rules. They would have actually memorized much of the Old Testament. They knew their stuff. But this dude's heart was not impacted by the knowledge of his mind. He knew a bunch of stuff, but he didn't want to do it. It didn't impact his heart. See, most of us, I would say, in my experience, our knowledge of who God is and God's word far exceeds our obedience. You guys hearing me? I believe that if you would do what you knew, right, you'd be brand new. The problem is that they see right through. That's the problem. See, we don't, listen, no pastor's going to tell you quit reading your Bible, but I'll just say that some of us need to stop reading more and start doing what you already read. See, if the church people would start doing what they already know. See, how many people in here know that you shouldn't lie? Come on now. Raise your hand, right? Yeah. How many people in here know you're not supposed to get all tore up drunk? Come on now, right? Yeah. How many people know you're not supposed to be greedy? Right? So start obeying that stuff. How many people know, I'm going to hammer this thing to the day I'm dead. How many people know that the Bible says to stop neglecting meeting together? Come on. And how many people keep blowing church off because it's not convenient? He's looking for devotion, y'all. Just do that. What happens to a church when people walk in and the place is rocking and it's packed and people are praising God like crazy? They walk in, "Whoa, what's going on here?" Would you agree? You get that same feeling when the room's empty? Guess who can fix that problem? Raise your hand. Why isn't everyone raising their hand? Because you won't do it. Devotion. devotion. These people were filled with greed and wickedness. They were leveraging religion for their own gain. And Jesus said, the way to stop that is to stop doing that and give things to the poor. They needed a complete 180 in their life. And that's what he was calling for. Okay, so first thing here is this phoniness that God's calling people to the mat on. You say you're one thing, but you're not. You just look religious. You look religious, but you're not. You have a cross. You have a Z sticker on your car. You have a Revolution sticker on your car. Whatever it is. You got a Bible on your dashboard, but you don't act the way you say you are. What your life, when someone reads you, they don't read this. And that's what's keeping people from your Savior. You guys like truth around here, I hope. Yeah. I'm just going to do what I feel I'm supposed to do, right? You're cool with that? All right. So here's the next one. Look over at verse 42. Let's just see if we're, you know, we don't want to fall victim to this stuff, right? Look at 42. What sorrow awaits you, Pharisees, for you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb gardens, but you ignore justice and the love of God. You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. And so I want to address a couple of things here because I think it's important, because you know at our church we don't talk about tithing. We talk about giving. We talk about praying and giving. But out of the mouth of Jesus Christ, he says we should tithe. And so when I or Mike or whoever it is that's up here that's leading you in prayer and asking God, okay, what is it that I should do? I'm just going to say that I believe that the ground level, the beginning, where we start, okay, God, show me what I should give. Tell me what I should give. Should be starting at, do you know what tithes means? 10. It starts at 10% of your income. Now, Jesus Christ said, did you guys read that? Or did I make it up? You should tithe. So that's where we should start. 10% of what you make goes back to God. Right. Now listen, if you pray and God says, hey, listen, brother or sister, you're 10%, I appreciate that's what you're giving, that's what I want you to give, and no more, awesome. You'll find that out in prayer. But if you're praying, he says, no, I want you at this number, obey. See, we don't need to learn more. What do we need to do? Obey more, right? Obey more. Maybe if you're obedient with what he's given, maybe you'll get some more. I'm just kind of giving you a little help there. That was free. I'm just saying, if maybe you want a little bit more, maybe be obedient with what he's given. Look at, so he says, listen, I want you to tithe. So what he's saying is that you have this herb garden and it grows, you have increase, God brought the increase, and you've got these herbs, and you take a little bit, like I made fun of earlier, you take, you know, 9 leaves for me and 1 for you, God, and 9 for me and 1 for you, and that's awesome. But that what he's saying is that you do that, and that's good. We should do that. 10% of our increase goes to God. I get that. When the baskets come, 10% go in. But he says, what you're doing is you're giving your offering, but you're neglecting things that are even more important than that. Like the love of God. How do you pass that one up? I don't ever want to be the church that comes in and we announce online about this awesome offering that we got. Whoa, we got $1 million this week. We got $75,000 this week. Like, that's something to be proud of. If that money doesn't like transfer or change into doing something so that other people can experience the love of God or experience Christ in some way, then who cares about the stupid offering? Keep your money, right? It has to actually do something. Last week, I told you about Manny and Wilma wanting 30 Bibles. They got tons of people coming to know the Lord over in Mexico. On the side of a mountain. And Manny called me. He said, listen, we're flooded with people, and I got all these kids, and they don't have Bibles, and would you guys consider getting us 30 Bibles for the kids? I was like, man, I don't know. It's a lot of money. They're 12 bucks a piece. He's like, you know, anything you could do. So I came to you guys and we talked about it and I offered it out there. And here, these, see these right here? These are the kids' Bibles. The pink ones are for the girls and the blue ones are for little boys. But we didn't raise money for 30. We raised money for 68 of them. Yeah, that was awesome. That was awesome. Listen, I want to take a second. I want to pray just like real quick because I want to be obedient, right? Remember I told you in the offering, be obedient to what God tells you. I want to be obedient right now. So just pray with me for a minute. Lord, every single one of these, no, you know what? No, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we are obedient. Thank you, Lord, that you spoke loud and clear to us. Thank you, Lord, for these people responding when you called. And Lord, I thank you for each and every Bible that is here. I thank you for every single life that will be impacted by the word of God. This pile represents 68 possibilities or more. And so Lord, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that each and every one of these Bibles will get into the hands of someone who desperately needs you. And I thank you, Lord, that your word is powerful, that it always accomplishes what it sets out to do, and that in the hands of someone in need, you will transform their life because they have received this gift of your word. We love your word. We love Manny and Wilma. We love what you're doing down there. We love what you're doing here. We thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So listen, we took this offering, and it was last week. This is so dangerous, but I just got to tell you. Last week was one of the best offerings we've had here in like 2 years. It wasn't much, but it was a little bit over budget, but it was good. But if I just got up here and said, hey man, great guys, you gave good. That's awesome. Who cares? Right there. If what we give doesn't cause this stuff to happen, we don't ignore the greater things, the love of God that they're going to find out about when they open these books. That's what has to happen, right? And it says here we put some offering in the box where we might show up, but we ignore the more important things than that. You know, you wake up in the morning and you're getting ready to go to work or go to a friend's house or go to church, whatever you're doing, and you wake up and you brush your hair, right? I don't have to do that anymore. But you guys brush your hair, not Robert, but most of you. And you brush your teeth, I hope. You put your deodorant on, I hope. And you get a nice shirt, and maybe if you're going somewhere nice, you might even, you know, put on a tie or something and get the right shoes and socks and all that kind of stuff, right? That's good to do, right? Look nice, go out, right? I didn't mention my pants. You guys told me I could go out with no pants on. So you tithe off your herbs, but you neglect the most important things. And that's what's going on in the church. We're neglecting to show the love of God to the people who so desperately need it. And that's why they won't come to our church. Why would I want to go to a church filled with you guys? I'm just saying that not because I don't love you. I love you guys. And God's at work here, and he's changing us. I'm watching it in the mirror. I'm watching it in you. Every week, I see it. It's awesome. But I'm just saying no one's graduated yet. I certainly have not. We've got a long way to go. Remember last week? We talked about the fertile ground where God birthed like a massive, massive church explosion. Well, they were giving of their resources, like the people tithing, right? They were giving, but it didn't stop there. The people gave their resources, but they also were helping one another by opening up their homes, sharing their meals. As a matter of fact, it goes on to say that they shared everything that they had. So they didn't just sell their stuff and take the money and give it to the apostles. It also said they shared their stuff. So some stuff got sold and the money came to go help people. Other stuff got kept, but we shared it with everybody. And it goes on to say that there was no needy people among them. See, they weren't just tithing. They weren't ignoring the big things. They were focusing on the big things. They weren't just giving a couple bucks and walking away and not engaging in the life of the church. They were involved. They were engaged. And that's what he wants us to do. So don't ignore the big things. And by no means am I telling you don't give. You need to give too. Giving's important. Giving is needed. I mean, we could talk about the practical, like the lights here that are on right now, the rent that we pay so we could gather here, the toilet paper you're going to use, the tissues you're going to use, the creamer that you're going to drink, whatever it is, all that stuff. That's practical. It's important. We all love it, right? I like it. Those are important things. We got to pay for that stuff, so you got to give. But God also wants to release you from the thing that got a hold on you, so we give of that. Jesus talks about money a lot because he's going after your heart, and sometimes your heart's owned by money and the desire to possess more and more, so it controls you, and he doesn't want it to control you because you should only have one master, and that's Jesus. You can't serve two masters. So that's why we need to give too, because he's doing a work in this building. He's doing a work in you. Both, right? Here's the next thing here. Look at verse 52. What sorrow awaits you, experts in religious law, for you remove the key to knowledge from the people. And it goes on, it says, you don't enter the kingdom. These guys have the Bible memorized, and they're not saved. Come on. Right? Well, Lord, I thought that if I studied more, I thought if I went to church more, I thought if I prayed more, I thought if I gave more, right? No. There's nothing to do with that. Those are the things you do because you're responding in love and gratitude that God saved your sorry hide. But those things don't get you saved. So they had the Bible memorized, but they weren't even getting in. And because it never hit their heart what they had in their head, they prevent others from entering too. Because you start doing what they do, and you ain't getting in either. So think about this. We're supposed to go make disciples. That means we're supposed to replicate who we are. Careful who you're replicating. You got to be careful who you're replicating. If you were the example of Jesus on this earth, would the church be healthy if there was millions of you? I'm just saying, right? Can I sit down here with you? Because I'm in it. In the same way. I'm not ripping you and saying I'm good because I have a long way to go. A long way to go. And there's parts of me that I don't want replicated in you. I don't. But it says here that they remove the key to knowledge from the people. What does that mean? Let me give you a couple of examples that I think might be helpful. In 2008, I went back to my hometown in Sharon, Massachusetts, and I desperately want my mom to get saved. She's Jewish. Pray for her. Her name's Joanne. I want my mom to get saved, right? She's great. I love my mom. If anyone was getting in on merit, she's in. Front of the line. Great lady. Doesn't drink, doesn't cuss, doesn't smoke, doesn't do nothing. She's been with one man her whole life. Just an angel of a woman. It's not going to get her anywhere. I want her to get saved. So like I pray for her and stuff. Not enough, but I pray for her. And so when I'm going back home to Massachusetts, I'm thinking, okay, my sole intention of this trip is to get this woman saved, right? So how do I do that? So I start thinking, right, what am I going to do? I'm going to temple with her. So I grew up in Sharon, Massachusetts. I was bar mitzvahed. I went to Hebrew school, all of that at Temple Adath Sharon. This little temple, little conservative Jewish synagogue in Sharon, down this little side street. And so I decided I'm going to go with her so I can get some common ground, and hopefully a gospel conversation comes out of our visit. So I go to the temple, and they go through all the rituals, and they go through all the customs, and they're speaking in Hebrew, and I don't understand a word they're saying, but I can tell you what I can say it, but I don't know what it means. And we get through the service, and I'm in the lobby with my mom, and the service comes to a conclusion. Here comes the rabbi out into the lobby, and I'm just like, I'm coming undone, man. Like, I am, because it smells like death. right? It's death because they're not getting anywhere. And they're not helping these people to find a relationship with the Lord. And I'm just dying in there, right? But meanwhile, while I'm in the seats at the time, earlier on while they're doing all this stuff, I open up one of the Bibles that are in the pews, right? And I'm looking through it. And I noticed something that was really peculiar. Do you guys know how many books are in the Bible? 66, right? They weren't all in theirs. Listen, not only were they not all in there, not even all of the Old Testament books were in their Bibles. I mean, this, no. Torah, yes. They had some of the other stuff. They had some Isaiah, some Ezekiel, some Joel, right? Some Hosea. They had some of it. They didn't have all of it. And I'm thinking, man, this is kind of weird, right? So we're in the lobby now. And the guy, the rabbi comes out and he asked me to do, there's a section of the ceremony they do every single week. It's called an aliyah. And I don't even know what that means, but you have an aliyah. And so what they do is they call on someone and they come up and you come up to the pulpit and they've got the actual Torah open up. And that's like holy, right? And they don't like mark in it with highlighters and stuff like you guys do, right? That's like holy. You might strike dead if you touch this thing. It's so holy that they point to the section of the Torah that you're supposed to read with a pointer and you take your tassels, right? Your little tallis, and you take it and you touch it and kiss it and then read. That's what they do. So he calls me, and I'm like, I'm in my seat going. He's like, right? First of all, I don't believe in what they're doing, and I can't read Hebrew, right? So what am I going to do? So my mom goes up on my behalf, and she reads. So at the end of the service, now he comes down. He's like, what's going on, Joanne? And we've been lifelong members there. My name's on the wall from where I was bar mitzvahed. Like, I'm Moses from this temple, right? That's a big deal. And so here I am, Moses from the temple, and I'm denying the rabbi going like this in my seat, and I won't go up on the stage. He's like, what's going on, Joanne? Why, what's going on? And I'm like, listen, I don't believe in what you're doing, and I don't read Hebrew, so I can't go up there. He goes, what do you mean you don't believe in what I'm doing? I said, sir, I looked at your Bibles. Where's the rest of it? Where's the rest of Isaiah? Where's the rest of Ezekiel? How are these people going to make a quality choice if you're withholding information from them? Did you hear what I just read to you a minute ago, right? You withhold the knowledge from the people. And I asked him, I said, why are you doing it? He goes, listen, talk about custom. Listen, that's just how we do it. You've got to be kidding me. That's just how we do it. I said, let me ask you a question then, sir. Have you read Isaiah 53? Because Isaiah 53, if you guys know what Isaiah 53 is, you might as well have a picture of Jesus on. When you open up Isaiah 53, it's got sandals and a robe and long, beautiful hair. And it's Jesus, right? In the Old Testament, about the guy who was going to be slain for your stuff that you did and go to the cross and die for you. Like, it's all in there. And I said to the rabbi, I said, let me ask you a question. Have you read Isaiah 53? Yes, sir, I have. Who are they talking about? He says, well, when the Messiah comes back, if it's Jesus, it won't surprise me. I looked over at my mother. I thought she was going to kill him with a spoon. But this whole idea of him being God, they've taken it too far, he said. The good news, and very few of you know this, Mary knows it, but very few of you know this. The very next day, of course, I wanted to go to church up there. So I went to the little Baptist church the next morning. Great service. 2008, still remember the sermon. Be a generator of love. Philip Andre, love the guy. Get done with the service and I'm leaving and pastor's at the door and he's shaking hands because that's what we preachers do. I'm going to do that in a few minutes. And I go to the door and I shake his hand. I'm like, oh, pastor, great service. Great, great message. I mean, I'm really encouraged. Awesome. And I go like this and the rabbi was standing right there at the Baptist church. I was like, Listen. I looked at him. I still had my hand in Philip's hand. I went, dude, what are you doing here? You're my mother's rabbi. He's like, so I like this place and I like the teaching, so I come. But please don't tell anybody I was here. So I'm thinking, this is my thought. I make my plans, all right? I'm thinking, hold this guy. I'm going to get my mother at the house, right? And we're coming back here and she's going to get saved. And the pastor told me, don't do that because he and I are good friends. He's come to my house. We're studying the Bible together. Trust it. Trust God. Let it go. And I did. You know, I did. But that's what they do. They withhold the knowledge from the people. Listen, that's not just in the temple. That's in the church. Do you know that there's people, there's churches that say, this is crazy, that if you didn't get saved in a church that preaches King James only, you're not saved. You've heard this, right? Yeah. Let me ask you a question. When I read our text earlier, did you understand it? Was any of it like, what is he talking about? Anyone? Listen to this. You ready? What's our text? 11:37. This is awesome. And he spake, a certain Pharisee besought him to dine with him, and he went in and sat down to meat, M-E-A-T. That's weird. And when the Pharisee saw it, he marveled that he had not first washed before dinner. And the Lord said unto him, now do ye Pharisees make clean the outside of the cup and the platter, but your inward part is full of ravening and wickedness. Ye fools, do not he that made that which is without make that which is within also? Please. I'm losing you. But rather give alms of such things as you have, and behold, all things are clean unto you. What the heck are they even saying here? But woe unto you, Pharisees, for ye tithe mint and rue and all manner of herbs, and pass over judgment and the love of God. These ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone. Woe unto you, Pharisees, for ye love the uppermost seats in the synagogues and greetings in the markets. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are as graves which appear not, and the men that walk over them are not aware of them. Woe unto you, ye lawyers, for ye laid men with burdens grievous to be borne, and ye yourselves touch not the burdens with one of your fingers. Woe unto you, for ye build the sepulchres of the prophets, and your fathers killed them. Truly ye bear witness that ye allow the deeds of your fathers, for they indeed killed them, and ye build their sepulchres. Is anyone even remotely clueless? I mean, I have no idea what I've just read. You got a blank. That just hurts my brain. You know what it makes me? It makes me feel stupid. Does anyone else honestly feel stupid? Because I do. I feel like this is speaking over me instead of God speaking to me. And Paul talks about the tongues, and we can argue about whether there's angelic tongues or not tongues, but he talks about that he speaks in tongues, but he'd rather speak in like five clear words that you'd understand than what does he say, thousands in an angelic tongue. Be clear. God wants to speak to his people. And so that's why we use the translation that we use, just so that we can understand. And so Revolution Church should always make it easy and inviting for new people to meet the Lord and experience his love and to understand his word and not complicate it by setting up a bunch of customs, dress codes, and hard to understand Bible verbiage that no one can comprehend as the guy's up there reading it. Let me ask you a question. If you loved someone and you were inviting them to your house for dinner, would you put up, anyone ever seen American Ninja Warrior? Anyone ever see that show? Would you set one of those up on your front walk before they got in the house? Why? Because you love them. You want to make it easy for them to come, right? Make it easy for people to come to know the Lord. Don't put up a bunch of customs and obligations that keep them from that. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:1, my message was plain, no lofty words and impressive wisdom. So if the Bible says that, why are we changing that? One of the most common answers given as to why people don't go to church is hypocrisy. We're fake. We're phony. We have a mask. It's a veneer. It's not really who we are. And they say they claim to be this big old Christian. They go to church every weekend, but, and fill in the blank. We have to watch our talk, and we have to watch our actions. And we have to ask, are my words representing and attracting others to my Savior's teachings? Are my words and my life, the way I live it out before other men and women, is it reflecting what I'm actually being poured into every single day and every single week? More importantly, are my actions attracting others to my Savior himself? Or are they pushing us away? Is there a chasm between who I claim to be and who I am? Has the knowledge of God that I've gained in my head transformed who I am? These are questions we need to ask all the time. Listen, if you want Jesus Christ glorified in his church, then you need to answer these questions. I need to answer these questions all the time. Nobody likes unauthentic. People see through it. And if you're asking people to come to church all the time and they're not coming, you need to stop blaming them and start looking at yourself. You give them good reason to come to your church and they will run here. Amen? Amen. We're going to take communion now. Could I get a couple of folks to come up here and pass these elements out, please? And then we're going to take it together as a family. I'd like for you to take a moment and just bow your head. You'll hear the feet of the communion giver. He'll approach you, and you could receive those elements and hold on to them. But take a few minutes now and kind of reflect on what you heard. Maybe take a look at your life. Evaluate. Think of the way you act. Think of the things you do. Think of the things you say. And in light of that, think of the words that you heard tonight from God's word. And let him take a few minutes and let him do a little work inside of you. Start with thinking about your church. Let him put a vision in your head of what your church would be like and how it would impact the world. And start thinking about, Lord, what is it that I can do to help that happen? Or perhaps, what is it that I am doing that's keeping that from happening?